I prepared a couple of slides on research which recently published in the Defense and Peace Economics. And this research aimed to measure the economic cost of revolution and the subsequent Iran and Iraq war for Iranians. I prepared a couple of slides which I now share it here, and within the next 20, 30 minutes, I will go ahead with this. Okay, I hope that you see. The economic cost of Islamic revolution and the war for the case of Iran, this is the application of synthetic control method in order to measure the income loss for average Iranians. When it comes to the question of economic cost of Iran, in the literature, there have been efforts to measure a variety of aspects of this cost. However, one question remained more or less unanswered in this literature, and that was this question: what would Iranian economy have looked like in the absence of revolution war with Iraq? The answer to this question was a bit difficult, because in order to have a reliable answer to this question, one was needed to have a counterfactual Iran, a synthetic Iran, which was able to replicate and to generate the Iranian economic situation before the shock of revolution in 1978. And in that case, of course, if there was an effect from revolution, the war, most likely in a negative way, so we were able to estimate this effect. So the earlier studies, which I will review also shortly, basically tried to measure the economic costs imposed on Iranian infrastructure, damages, and so on and so forth. However, the income loss, the place and the situation that Iranians could reach if these wave of revolution and the protests was not happening, war, of course, this was not clearly answered. So this is something that this study trying to basically reflect on that. Of course, one answer provided by the Ayatollah Khomeini, in which basically one can say he's trying to exactly answer this question which I'm raising here in this research. However, the answer that Ayatollah is providing basically is not based on the statistics and data that we basically verified empirically. He believes, of course, that if this revolution was not happening, only God knows what the state our country would be in today. And he encourages us to compare the situation of countries in Asia and Africa, and was saying that if a revolution was not happening, our situation was most likely in a much more worse situation than these countries. And basically this regime changed from monarchy to the Islamic Republic, basically that was an opportunity to promote and progress. So we try to shed more light on this question and provide more empirically supported evidences on this counterfactual question. So most of you who are familiar with the history of recent Iran, what happened 4 decades ago in a form of wave of revolution, which started more or less in the 1977 as an open resistance against the Shah, which intensified during the 1978, much more severe way, and resulted to departure of the Shah from Iran and victory of revolution in the 11th February 1979. So our focus treatment year here in this context in 1978 as the specific year which the revolutionary movement peaked significantly. However, we have also For our estimation calculation, we have also looked at 1977, which has been mentioned by some scholars and some historians as most likely the starting point of resistance against the Pahlavi monarchy system. And of course, subsequent war, this is a joint shock for the case study that we are reviewing, is a composite shock. Revolution, the war started in 1980 and last ended in 1988. So it is hard to separate these two events from each other. And so for this reason, our focus, when we talk about the shock of revolution and the war with Iraq. There are a couple of studies that I just mentioned in the literature. Briefly select a few of them, and there are more, of course, in the paper itself that you can also look at them. Alan Al-Nasrawi in 1986, of course, he calculated the economic cost imposed on Iranian side for the first 6 years of the war. And basically, his calculation is trying to measure the reduction of Iranian oil production and exports, and basically the damage which imposed on some infrastructures and additional costs of doing trade for Iran because of the situation of the war and the need to change the trading routes, which imposed higher trading costs. We come to the calculation, the numbers that within the first 6 years, cost for Iranian side was about, the total estimated cost was around $240 billion. Amir Ahmadi also used secondary information, and basically he calculated the economic costs for the Iranian side, including the damage on infrastructure, of course, excluding the human cost and the opportunity cost of military expenditures and so on and so forth. He reached a number close to $600 billion for the period of the 8 years war, and the Mufid also in his calculation reached more or less to the similar numbers. My calculation for the lost income for average Iranians taking the whole population during the 1978-1988 into account on average is much more than this, is $1.5 trillion. And of course, there are more studies. Mohammad also have looked at the economic costs imposed on Iranian side as a result of regime change and the war, but not only the war period, but until the year 2010, based on different scenarios. As I said, all these studies basically have important contribution to shed more light on the damage that the war and the revolution imposed on the Iranian economy. However, to answer that question, which I raised at the beginning, namely, what would Iran economy have looked like then since of revolution and the war, basically we need a counterfactual Iran or synthetic Iran. We use a synthetic method, control method, which is by now an established methodology to find out the causal impact of exogenous shocks. I've been using different research questions and disciplines. Here we are applying this method to identify the causal effect of this political change and turmoil on one important economic indicator, namely income per capita, which is understandable for all of us. And it is one of the most important indicate and proxy for economic development. Of course, economic development is a much more comprehensive topic, which includes also what is happening on education side, what is happening on income inequality, health, and so on and so forth. But here we focus on income per capita. And of course, we quantify this effect. I will show it to you briefly how we are going to do this. The logic is, of course, we need a synthetic Iran, counterfactual Iran, which I just said is quite similar to Iranian example before the shock of revolution in a term of economic development, in a term of the predictor of income, namely the characteristic, the socioeconomic characteristic of the synthetic Iran should be similar to Iran, or as much as possible close to the Iran, real Iran. And if we manage to find that, let's say, copy of Iran, With this method, basically, the major advantage of this method is to produce, is give us this counterfactual Iran. Basically, the estimation would then be possible. And we also show, you know, to what extent this estimation that we have are sensitive to inclusion, exclusion of countries from this counterfactual, this pool of countries which are producing counterfactual Iran. And I will also show it to you, to you these sensitivity checks that we have done to make sure that these estimations, as much as possible, are reliable estimations. Basically, and the other things that regarding the synthetic control method, it's important to mention that this counterfactual Iran basically is based on a weighted average of combination of different countries which are best able to predict the situation of Iran before revolution. So in our pool of donor pool countries, sample which are meant to produce synthetic Iran, there are several countries, but not all of them receiving equal weight to generate the synthetic Iran. And the model try to basically find the optimum weights to these selected number of these countries, which then make it possible for us to have a reliable counterfactual example of Iran. The method that I said is quite established, and I mean, since the first work which I've been publishing, American Economic Review, by Abadi and colleagues, they use this method to measure the economic cost of conflict in the case of Basque Country in Spain. And since then, we are observing more and more application of this method in different fields. Here, there are studies which basically are focusing on economic cost of conflict using this method. There is this paper, as you see, on the opportunity cost of conflict for the case of the second intifada in Israel from 2000 to 2005. And they calculated significant economic costs imposed on Israeli citizens as a result of this conflict with Palestine, around $2,000 per person for the period of conflict, income loss for Israeli part. We have also one application of this method for the case of effects of international sanctions during the 2012 and 2013 for the Iranian economy, the income loss, which publishing economic letters. And there are a series of other studies which have been applied in the case of Turkey, and for the Arab Spring example, Tunisia, Egypt, and Libya. So what was the economic cost of Arab Spring? And this method basically proved to be quite helpful to answer this type of question. I've also recently written a paper on the years of life lost to the Iranian Revolution, the war. Here I focus on the life expectancy and the aspects of this transition from regime change and the war, which affected life expectancy of Iranians, and which gives us a more broader picture of the situation regarding these economic consequences of the war. Focus change from income to the life expectancy and the sanction also. This is another study which I'm working on that. So the data that we have is basically the time period that we are looking from 1970 to 1988. We have a couple of years before revolution, 1970 to 1977. And some years after the shock of revolution during the war, namely 1978 to 1988. So the ending is 1988. So, and the treatment shock, the treatment year, the year that the shock is imposed, the 1978. Or in the robustness check, we also tried 1977, because as I said, there are studies and research which says that the open resistance against the Shah and revolutionary movement started in 1977. The synthetic Iran need a donor pool. From this donor pool, we are selecting the countries which are best and generate the real Iran before the shock of revolution. And basically in this donor sample, in this sample that we are using to generate the synthetic Iran, I decided to focus on the countries which are belonging to the Middle East and North Africa, and also the members of the organization Petroleum Exporting Countries, OPEC. So the reason why I focus on this sample, because the countries in these areas share similarities in variety of aspects, from informal institutions, from geographical location, from the reliance on the oil. So this is a better approach to rather make it very open and ask the model to basically find the most optimum from a global sample. Of course, in the robustness checks, I also remove this distraction and try to find out the synthetic Iran from a global sample without imposing a prior restriction on a specific region. But here in the main result, the sample that that I'm trying to find out the synthetic Iran is coming from the MENA region and the OPEC countries. And basically here, thing that we are trying to find out that which countries from these donor groups are best generating the Iran before the shock of revolution. And if that generation happened, if that counterfactual, that synthetic Iran is generated, of course, we expect to see a divergence in the income per capita of real Iran and a synthetic Iran. Synthetic Iran showing the situation when there is no war and revolution for case of Iran. So it's a hypothetical situation in which Iran could be there at the absence of revolution and the war. So the difference between the income per capita of real Iran and the counterfactual Iran is basically is a measure that we are looking for as a measure of income loss. Income loss, and this is something that we are trying to do. Of course, as we can imagine, to have an unbiased estimation of income loss for Iran, we need to have a group of countries in the donor sample which are not have the same problem as in Iran. Namely, they are not under the influence, or they have not been under the influence of war, revolution, any sort of other major conflict and protests and so on and so forth. Otherwise, if you put other countries which have the same experience as in Iran, our estimation are biased. So I excluded a couple of countries, which for sure, I mean, Iraq is one of them, because that was a part of war, and Lebanon and Israel, which were into conflict in the 80s, were also excluded, and the other countries which had some missing information. So at the end, 11 countries remained to build the counterfactual Iran from the initial 20 countries. So the method, as I said, does not treat each of these 11 countries equally to generate the counterfactual Iran. It gives some higher weights to some of them and lower weights to some of them. Sometimes give the weight of zero to others which are not able to generate the real Iran experience before the war and revolution. So therefore, the model tried to assign a specific weight between zero and one to these countries in the donor sample. And the idea is that these weights should be given in a way that basically replicate the income per capita of Iran as close as possible before the revolution and the war. And when the model minimizes the distance between income per capita of Iran and income per capita of counterfactual Iran before revolution, and it's when it's minimizing the distance between the predictor of income per capita in Iran and predictor of income per capita in its counterfactual case, then we are rather in a good situation to estimate the causal impact of this problem for Iran. So this is a quite important assumption and quite important condition to have a successful basically calculation to generate the causal effect of the revolution and the war, the so-called treatment effect, which is the difference between income per capita of Iran and income per capita of counterfactual Iran for the years after the shock, namely after the 1978. So the results, which are the countries in the main results are generating the counterfactual Iran? These are the countries, the five countries from this sample of 11 countries have been selected by the synthetic control method as the candidates for generating synthetic Iran. It gives 56% weight to the Tunisia, 16% to Venezuela, 13% Saudi Arabia, 12% Oman, 1.6% to Algeria. And as you see, there are countries which have received the weight of zero. So that means the synthetic copy of Iran is generated by 56% of situation in Tunisia, 16% in Venezuela, and so on and so forth. So this combination is able to regenerate the economic situation of Iran before the 1978, very closely in a very, with the minimum errors and minimum residuals here. So you see that here, for example, in this table, it is the comparison between real Iran and synthetic Iran. These are the GDP per capita of Iran before the revolution, before the 1978, in the year 1976, 1974, 1979. And these are the real observation US dollar adjusted for inflation. And you see the synthetic Iran is very much close to the real Iran in terms of generating economic situation of Iran before revolution. And these are the set of predictor of income. It should be there in order to have also a group of countries which are not only reflecting the Iranian income per capita before the shock of revolution, but also from the social, demographic characteristics basically are close to Iran. And the difference between Iran and synthetic Iran is reflected here. You see the difference is quite small. The reason that we are emphasizing synthetic method is more helpful because if we look at the unweighted average of these variables for the countries which had a higher weight of zero, assumed to give these basically optimum weights to these countries, you see the model is very poor in terms of predicting the economic situation of real Iran before revolution, and the difference is quite sizable and large. So that is the reason that the synthetic method is needed, and this weighted average of countries in Donapur is quite important to generate a good situation of Iran before revolution. And here is the output of the main result, which shows where Iran was before revolution and what happened after revolution, and where Iran could be if the revolution and the war was not happening. So the solid line is the situation of income per capita of Iran from 1970 to 1988. You see it is a close trend between Iran and the synthetic Iran before the revolution. And the treatment here is in 1978. And after that, the synthetic Iran was developing like this. Synthetic Iran, which had not experienced the war and revolution, and the real Iran is dropping significantly. So the distance between these two lines are the economic costs of revolution and the war, which is also shown in this figure. So you see the income gap between Iran and the real Iran, the synthetic Iran, is almost zero before the shock of revolution. And the revolution happened, basically, the gap become negative, and these dash lines are statistical significance. Whether this effect that we are estimating statistically is different from zero, so it's not only economically significant, highly negative, which is reflected by this number here on the vertical axis. This is the income loss for each Iranian on average. Which are calculated to be basically around $3,000 per person. So an average Iranian has the accumulated loss of average Iranian is $36,000 when we take the population of Iran entire, come from 1978 to 1988, around 44 million people. So the total income loss at the country level would be around $1.5 trillion, much higher than the previous estimation by the other papers. Of course, as I said, the results needs to be checked to find out whether to what extent these results are sensitive to a specific robustness checks. One of the things which is common in the robustness check in this literature is to apply the same method to other countries in this donor group. If we found out the similar shock which happened to other countries, result to the same picture as in the case of Iran, probably we need to think again whether it was really the revolution and the war which is resulting to this picture or something else. We found out in the so-called in a space plausible test, when we apply this synthetic control method to other countries in this group, we found that there are no other plausible runs that outperform or equal the effect estimate for Iran. So Iran is really basically the effects of Iran is dominant, and no other countries that we have imposed this shock on them is able to generate the same picture as Iran. We have also done in-time plausibles, and namely we have changed the treatment year to other years, which basically could not result to the same consequences for income per capita. One of these years is 1975, the other is 1980. It turned out that really the divergence between Iran, the real Iran, the counterfactual Iran, happens at the time of revolution. So other times and periods basically are not leading to this result. And we also check whether inclusion of one important country in this sample of donor sample, which is used to generate synthetic Iran, is driving these results. We exclude in the first round the most important country with the higher weights and re-estimate the model and check it. And then in the second case, we again drop the most important country with the highest weight and check it. And it turns out that the synthetic control results are robust to exclusion of influential important countries in the donor sample. And as I said, the one final thing that we did, instead of focusing on the MENA region and OPEC countries to find where is the counterfactual Iran, the synthetic Iran, extended the sample to the global sample and again did this exercise and found out that the results are quite robust to this. So in 2 minutes, again, I summarize what we did. That was the question that we raised, what would the Iran economy have looked like in the absence of revolution and the war? I think that one method that can answer this question in a transparent way, the synthetic control method. The advantage is that it helps us to answer the causal effects of war, and it gives us a counterfactual situation for Iranian economy if this war and if this revolution was not happening. Of course, what the synthetic control method does not show us is the mechanism, the transmission mechanism of what happened. Which basically the income of Iran so massively reduced compared to its counterfactual. So the mechanism needs more analysis. This is a summary of the estimation. So average Iranian per capita loss every year is around $3,000 and accumulated from during this period of 1978 to 1988, each Iranian on average have lost $34,000. Again, estimations. Why this happened? One possible reason is that these income loss come from high opportunity cost of spending on military. So the money which could be spent on education and health needed to be spent on the military as a result of conflict and violence. So that might be one reason of this. And of course, we see that the size of middle class also during the revolution and the war reduced significantly, which was minimum at the end of the war. And we are also experiencing a significant political factionalization as a result of revolution and the war, which increased the cost of economic coordination policies and increased the rent-seeking activities in Iran. So political factionalization probably was behind of this significant economic loss. Limitation that this paper had, it cannot separate the shock of revolution from shock of the war, because as you can see, you know, revolution happened in a very close contact with the war. And at best, we can say that the result of this study is measuring the composite treatment of joint treatment effects of the war and revolution together. Future research can probably better focus on understanding the transmission channel of these negative numbers that we identified here. So with this, I come to end of my presentation. I would be happy to answer your question. Thank you very much.